I want to continue on, and my message entitled tonight is called The Confirming of the Covenant. It's a carry-on of the blessed to be a blessing, but it's confirming the covenant. And so the covenant was basically this, that Abraham was blessed to be a blessing, and his people were blessed to be a blessing in the same way that you and I are blessed to be a blessing. We're redeemed children of God, and therefore we are blessed to be a blessing. Well, I want to pick it up in chapter 15 of Genesis and continue on with a thought entitled Confirming the Covenant. Have any of you ever ordered anything and then had confirmation in some way that it was on the way, it was being delivered? It's almost any more that you can't order something without them saying, all right, we'll give you a tracking number. You can follow us online. You can know right where it is on the truck or what city and how long it's going to take to get to you. All with me? So that's that confirmation thing. Shopping is an amazing thing. And in fact, we're in the Christmas season right now. And being in the Christmas season, people are going nuts shopping. And that whole Black Friday thing, you can have it. Do you know that the same sales that happened on Friday happened a week before? They just get everybody jacked up with enthusiasm and get you out there to mass shop to do what they do. Personally, I'd rather go to Amazon on Cyber Monday and order something that way that's delivered to my house, and I don't have to fight the people. In fact, I'm going to guarantee, thank you, like the book, and I'm going to guarantee you as time progresses, this is not just a prognostication, but it's just practicality. Because the nature of things, brick and mortar stores are going to begin to diminish in size, and you're going to find more and more stuff happening online just because of the convenience of it and the dollar saved. That's the trend that's happening. You may not like it, but you might as well get used to it. I'm going to tell you who's not going to like it is the major superstores and superstructures, because it's going to cost them. All right, that's a freebie. Other than the fact I talked about confirmation, in that when you order something, you know that they send you immediately, you know, if you order online, bing, you know, you get this confirmation, comes back, says your order has been shipped, it will arrive in approximately this day, and a tracking number, you can follow along with it. Well, in the same way, the Lord gave a promise to Abraham, and now he's confirming it once again. So in Genesis 15, I want you to start at verse 1, and we'll teach for about 30 minutes or so here and see where we land. After this, the word of the Lord came to Abram, note this, in a vision. Last time he probably appeared to him in person. And we had a little debate whether that was he actually showed up or he showed up in a vision. This time it says a vision. That time he probably came in person. He showed up. He had an encounter with the living Lord. And he says to him, do not be afraid, Abram. Now, there's two reasons for do not be afraid. Number one, because some of you know if God appeared to you, you'd probably be afraid. It'd be the natural thing you'd do. And so he always calms them. Whenever an angelic host shows up, it almost seems like it says, peace, be still. Don't be afraid. There's this whole thing of reassurance. You don't need to be alarmed that I'm here. And so he assures him that. But there's a bigger picture to that, because if you read the chapter before in chapter 14, it's where Abram and Lot separate. Remember, their flocks and herds and everything begin to grow so much that there's not enough land to support their flocks and herds. So they go out, and then Abram says, listen, Lot, wherever you go, I'll go in the opposite direction. You take first pick. You can have whatever land you want. He goes out. He looks to the plain down towards Sodom and Gomorrah. He says, I want that place. At that time, it was very fertile. And he heads towards the plains of Sodom, if you remember the story. He gets down there, and he gets into Sodom, very fertile place. Well, Abram, you know, he goes and he stays where he stays, and Lot goes to where he goes. So he pitched his tent towards Sodom, it says. Well, in the time, what ends up happening, there are five kings that rise up against them, and they come against and they take Lot captive. Now, these five kings are a confederation. So Abram has to go rescue his nephew Lot. You ever have to bail anybody out? He had to go bail his nephew out. So he goes after his family, and he goes, bails his family out, and he goes after him with 318 trained men, the Bible says in chapter 14. He defeats the five kings. And as he defeats them, he comes back with plunder. Note what happens. He comes to Jerusalem. He goes to the king of Salem, who is known as Melchizedek, or the king of Salem, which means Jerusalem, or the city of peace. So he goes to them, and the first thing that he does is he offers him a tenth of everything he has. Everybody say, before the law. Okay, this is tithing before the law. People always say, well, you know that tithing thing? It's an Old Testament thing. It's in the law, and it's not for today. It precedes the law. So he gives him a tenth of everything. Then he comes and gives back to the kings what belongs to them. He says, I won't take anything from you that does not belong to me that I've not earned or I've received, because I don't want you to then come back and have something in me. I made Abram rich. So that's the setting. Now you say, why is that important? Because how many of you know he could fear retaliation? How many of you know when somebody gets beat up, they don't like it, they're going to go get their big ugly brothers or cousins or whatever, and they're going to come and try to take you on. Now we had this clan called the Middlestead Boys. They lived out east of town from us, actually south of town on Highway 79. And I can remember these guys. They were a mean bunch. They were a nasty bunch. They were an ugly bunch. And they just wanted to fight at the drop of a hat. I remember one time we were sitting there walking home. It was snow. You know, we don't have so much snow here, but it was snow time down East Mead Street. As we're walking down East Mead Street, I remember their mom was driving the car and all the Middlestead Boys were in. And they went by and they were giving us the, you know, the finger that we were number one as we were going by. And there was another time that we were going by and we ended up, it was snow again. And we got in a conflict with them. They jumped us, and we had this battle. We started battling out with the Middlestead Boys. And so I said that to say all of this. Sometimes when you get into an encounter, somebody may not like it. They're going to go get reinforcements and come after you. So the basis of what I'm saying is do not be afraid. It's twofold. One is he has an encounter with God, but secondly, he may be afraid of the retaliation that comes back, the pushback. Pick it up at verse number one again. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward. Shield implies that I'm going to go before you and protect you. I'm going to watch over you. I'm going to protect you in battle. Psalms 91 says this. It says that no harm would befall us, no plague would come nigh our dwelling, that the Lord would lift up our foot so we would not stumble against a stone. We're going to tread upon the lion and the cobra. Come on, somebody. That's the word of the Lord to us. That's why Luke 10:19 says, behold, I give you authority. Really, it's the word power. Authority is the right word. To tread upon snakes and scorpions and overcome a little bit of the power of the enemy. No, it says all the power of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall harm you and hurt you. That doesn't mean that you go out and you go after demons and you're trying to take them head on. That's what I'm not talking about that per se. I'm talking about when you have pushback and the enemy comes against you, you have authority in Jesus' name to walk in victory and to overcome them. Do I hear an amen? So he says, I am your shield, and note this, your very great reward. Why is that? Because he gave up the spoils as tithe to the king of Melchizedek. How do you know when you give to God, you cannot outgive him, that it's going to come back, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Do I hear an amen? He says, I am going to be your very great reward. Though you may have given something tangible away in terms of silver or gold or robes or whatever you had, but I'm going to be even a greater reward. I don't know. I'll take God any day of the week. How about you guys? David said, the psalmist, he says, better is one day in your courts than 1,000 elsewhere. I'd rather be a gatekeeper in the house of the Lord than anything else. How about you? Why? Because he understood something, that in God's gates, in God's presence, when he got to be in the presence of the Lord and he was there one day in his courts, he was in the presence of the living Lord. And there's something about presence that shifts us, changes, and rearranges us. Verse number two. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless? He's putting him in remembrance of the promise that he had already given him. He says, and the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, you have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. So he says, Lord, I just want to put in remembrance. I'm just going to remind you of the promise. Let me tell you something. It is not wrong to remind God of the promise. He said it. He spoke it. Therefore, that's why it's very important for you when you get prophetic words. First of all, you assess it. Is this of the Lord? Does it bear witness with my spirit? Does it bear witness with the gifts on the inside of me? Then I would suggest to you the next thing that you would do is go ahead and transcribe that. Put it down on paper. Why is it? So you can look at it. You can meditate on it. You can begin to believe God for that word to come to pass in your life. Because when you're tempted by the enemy to be in despair or to be discouraged, like it's never going to happen, you can put the Father in remembrance of the prophetic word that he has given you, that he wants to bring to pass in your life. Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless? I don't have a child, and the one who's going to inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus. Now, remember, Eliezer is like his right-hand guy. He's like his right-hand assistant, but he's not his blood. Now, I'm going to tell you something. There's something about blood. And so he's saying, Lord, you promised me that blood would be there. And so he says, he says, this is going to be my heir. Get all that I belong to. Verse number four. Then the word of the Lord came to him. This man will not be your heir, but a son. So there's dialogue going on. Okay. Think about this for a moment. Where have you had the greatest times of talking to somebody? And it seems like you've just had, you just walk away feeling, man, that was a great conversation. Where has that happened at? Tell me, just give me some places where you've had great conversation with people. Anybody?
Around the campfire.
Campfire. Great place to have conversation. Somebody else?
Kitchen table.
Eating. Where at? Well, I guess so. Not me. I want to get out of there, man. I was like, I'm zoom, zoom, zoom. Yeah, Jason. The beach, okay, yeah. Those are all great places. So for Helen and I, one of the greatest places that we can have conversation is like usually sitting down at a table or sometimes when we're in bed at night before we go to bed. It's like you don't have pressures, you don't have worries, you just lay there and you start talking and talking and talking and talking. That's one of the best places. Or with other people, when you get with other people, one of the best places is just sitting down around a table where you've just eaten a meal and you fellowship one with another. And it just seems like there's a freedom there that you can talk and you start talking, you start talking, you start talking. All of a sudden the time slips away and you find out this about that person, this, and it just gels. And you know when you've had a great conversation. You also know when you've gotten with somebody, and it's like, man, you're carrying the weight of this sucker. Come on, could you help me out here? Could you help me out a little bit? You know, I need some help here. Dialogue is two-way. Conversation is two-way. That's what interaction is all about. Now, I personally find it pretty easy to talk to almost anybody, any place, any time. There's really only been two people that I can remember in my lifetime over the last histories that I've not been able to talk to. One was we were at a bank Christmas dinner with Helen. This was years ago. We're at a location, their bank always had a Christmas dinner, and so I always got invited because I was a spouse. So I went to this Christmas dinner, and then basically it was the bank president's husband. The bank president was a woman, and her husband was with her, and he was this guy that I think he worked in the woods, if I remember right. And so like, man, I could talk about working in the woods. I love the woods. I hunt. I fish. I mean, I can talk that all day long. So we're sitting there, and I'm trying to draw this conversation out of the guy because I could tell he's a fish out of the water. This guy ain't gelling with what's going on. He ain't digging the scene at all, if you know what I mean. He's like, this is. I'm like on a cat on a hot tin roof. I want to get out of here as soon as possible. So I'm talking with this guy, and I'm telling you, I am not getting anywhere. And I walked away from this. That's the one guy that I could not really talk to very much or get much out of. The other, believe it or not, is pretty well-known TV preacher. We'd had him at a conference. I'd brought him in. We'd flown him in for the conference, and he did his teaching, and then we sat in my office afterwards with another evangelist, and this guy was a pastor, well-known. If I told you who he is, you'd know him. He's on TV, has a television program, all of that. This guy on the platform, he just is a great Bible teacher. He can bring the heat, but you get him in a conversation with one or two people, the guy is like a deer caught in the headlights. He froze. And I'm sitting there, and my buddy and I, we're two kind of peas in the pod. We're talking and carrying on. Our hands are flying. You know, we eat like and we talk at the same time. Our hands are flying. We're feeding our face. Food's flying everywhere. And this guy's just sitting there like this. And he can't wait to get out of there. You were there. He was eating kind of like this. Watching and saying, how soon can I get out of here? So, again, conversation and communication happens at different levels. And the thing about it is this, is because you're not going to find everything to know about somebody in one setting. Relationships are developed. They take time. Debbie over here has been with me for a long time. She knows my likes and dislikes. If you were to ask her, what kind of food does John like? What kind of food does John not like? She could tell you. What kind of candy does John like? What kind of candy does John not like? She could tell you. She knows the way I like certain things because she's been around me. She has a relationship. You say, where are you going with this? I'm talking about the fact that every one of us need to get on a level playing field, just like Abraham did, that we're having an encounter with God, that we're able to talk and bring relational kind of communication, that God's not off in the stars someplace, but God is right here in the very midst of us, and he wants to have a conversation with us. He wants to interact with us. That's the kind of Father that you and I serve. That's the kind of God that Abraham is talking to. So he goes on and he says this to them. So he says, you know what? He says this. He speaks, and the word of the Lord said to him, this man will not be your heir, but a son. Didn't I tell you this? A son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir. He had already promised it to him. He's confirming the covenant to him. He took him outside and said, look up at the sky and count the stars. If indeed you can count them, then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. He wanted him to look and have a tangible picture. How do you know we deal with imaginations? That's why it says write things down, because when you write it down, it becomes plain. That's why Habakkuk, he says in Habakkuk, write the vision, make it plain, that a herald may run with it. Though it linger, it has an appointed time, and it will come to pass. Are you hearing me? Yep. Write the vision. Make it plain that a herald may, Habakkuk chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. He says, write it down. Why? That it make it plain so that you can see it. Everybody ought to have a life vision. You ought to have something tangible that you say, this is what I want to do when I finish the end of my life. Does everybody have it? Don't lift up your hands, because I'm going to tell you right now, some of you aren't going to have any, and you're going to be embarrassed. But you need to make this practice. You need. How many of you know you're not going to know if you hit something? If you know, if you never aimed at something, you're not going to know if you hit it. If I never had a goal or I never had an aim, how am I going to know if I reached it or not? I'm just kind of meandering around. The laser, have you ever been to a resort or a hotel or a motel that has one of these rivers that go through it? They call it a lazy river. And you can get on an inner tube and you can rent an inner tube or you can get an inner tube from the resort and you just float around. You don't have to do anything. You just go with the river because it's going a certain way and you just float with it and you just go down the lazy river. Well, we're not talking about that for our Christian life. Okay, that's fun on a vacation. That's fun on an anniversary. That's fun on a hot, sunny day. But that ain't what we're talking about. We're talking about your life, your call, your gift, your anointing. You say, well, I just work over here at this place, or I work over here at this place. It does not matter. I don't care where you're working. I don't care if you're working at Bimer. I don't care if you're working at Safeway. I don't care if you're working at Albertsons. I don't care if you're working at McDonald's right now, or Burger King right now, or Carl's Jr.'s right now. I don't care if you're working at Wendy's right now. I don't care if you're working at Hawaiian. Did I miss anybody? Any of these places right now? I don't care where you're working. Wherever you're working, whether it's Symantec, whether it's University of Oregon, Lane Community College, am I making it plain to anybody? If you're a salesperson, if you're a non-salesperson, if you work with a computer, you're online or offline, if you're working with your hands and you're pulling stuff off of a truck or putting stuff on a truck or you're delivering stuff, all of that has part and parcel to do with who you are, how you're wired, and where God is taking you. When I was in college, I had three jobs at one time. I was working at a mortuary. I had a small concrete business. And I was delivering bundle papers for the Register Guard to the kids that delivered them. Why? Because I believed in my vision. My vision was to complete my education and to pay for it. Hal and I didn't have any rich parents. We paid our way through college. We both worked our way through school. And so you do what you got to do to accomplish the vision. I heard your story the other night when you shared at Elizabeth about the fact that would we have power or not have power? Would we have a door or not a door? That just blessed me tremendously to know your heart. It says, I'm not giving up on the dream that God has placed on the inside of me. When God puts a deposit in you, you cannot let it go. You do what you do to accomplish it. I don't care where you're at, what stage of life you're at. God wants to arrest that and bring that forth and see that released. So he brings them out and says, count the stars, if indeed you can count them. And he said to them, so shall your offspring be. It's going to be. And it says in verse number 6, Abraham believed. Everybody say, believe. Believe the Lord, he credited to him his righteousness. That's a famous scripture, and I'm going to give you some other scriptures that go along with it. But let me tell you this. We're talking about more than believing in God. I mean, a lot of people believe in God. The Bible says in the book of James 2:19 that the demons believe in God and tremble. So I'm not talking about that because they even believe in God. Satan believes in God. Demons believe in God. I'm talking about believing in God. This belief is a belief in that what God can do and is willing to do and will do that moves into the realm of belief, into the realm of faith, that you lay hold of that which God has spoken, that there was a shift, there was a change that took place at that moment in time that he believed God and he credited to him as a righteousness, as if there was right standing with God. He was holy and pure and righteous before the Lord. He considered him that. Now take a look, if you would, please. Go to Romans chapter 4. And in Romans chapter 4, Paul uses this very same scripture a number of times as he quotes it in Romans chapter 4. Acts, Romans. Everybody there? Okay. Here's what it says. What then shall we say that Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh, discovered in this matter? If in fact Abram was justified by works, he had something to boast about, but not before God. What does the scripture say? Abraham, note this, he quotes him specifically, believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. When you look at the footnote and you go down, it shows that it's quoted from Genesis 15, verse 6. Also, jump over to verse 22, same passage. This is why it was credited to him as righteousness. The words credited to him were written not for him alone, but also for us to whom God was credited righteousness. For to us who believe in him, who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, he was delivered over to death for our sins and was raised to life for our justification. Let me tell you something. They got saved in the Old Testament just like we do in the New Testament, by faith, the same way. Are you hearing me? They believed in the Messiah that was yet to come. They believed in God the Father. They believed in what the word of the Lord said. So it says that he believed and he credited to him as righteousness. Verse 7, he also said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of the Ur of the Chaldees. It's a reminder. Everybody say a reminder. Ur of the Chaldees to give you this land. Why? To take possession of it. I want you to take possession. I'm giving you a gift. In order to receive the gift, you have to what? Lay hold of it. You have to take it. If somebody comes knocking at your door and they say, listen, somebody sent you this gift. It's in this package. It's gift wrap. Do you want it? You've got to do what? Yes, I want it. I'll receive it. I'll take it. Now, you've all heard me talk about my wife. My wife loves gifts. She loves gifts on her birthday. She says, my birthday is extended to the entire month. Now that she's reached a certain stage in life, she just celebrates the entire month. It's the month of April, if you're wondering. The day is April 5th, but she celebrates the whole month of April. She'll receive gifts every day of that month, even before and after. We're moving towards Christmas. And so we're talking about, what are we going to do for Christmas? Should I tell them what I'm going to get you for Christmas? You don't care. I'm buying her a pistol. I have a pistol. Matt, my son Matt gave me a pistol. Matt was in Afghanistan, so he got this great deal on an airborne 9mm 15-clip pistol. So he gave it to me, sent it to me. My wife goes, well, what? I want a pistol. Years ago, we were ministering, and a prophet came to our church. And as he was prophesying, the power of God was just falling all over the place. And he prophesied over hell, and he says, whatever he gets, you get. He didn't get anything that you don't get. You remember that when he prophesied that over you? He says, whatever he gets, you get. So Helen goes, where's my pistol? I want a pistol too. So John Mark comes home, and he says, yeah, there's this guy at work, and he's got a pistol, and it was his wife's, and he brought it home for Helen to try out. She put it in her hand. It's a little short. Mine's long barrel. Hers is a short barrel, And so it fit her hand perfectly, you know. Her hands are long and skinny. Mine are just big and fat. And so, anyway, that fit her hand better. It's a 9mm, so we don't have to buy any kind of bullets, but it's the same bullets. So they both fit both guns. It's interchangeable. You don't have to confuse them and all those kinds of things. So that's going to be her Christmas gift for this year, is her pistol that she's getting. So she'll take any gift. She loves gifts. Take possession of it. You have to do what? You have to reach out. Take possession of it. It becomes yours. It's kind of like this. How many of you know when you bought a house and you signed the title deed and you had to go pick up the keys and you were at the title office and you sat down and you signed your name on the dotted line and then they handed you the keys and then you went and you took possession of it? Or if you bought a car, new car, used new car, or whatever car, and you remember that when you bought that thing, they finally turned the keys over to you and you took possession of it once you had the keys. Can I tell you something? Keys speak of authority. He says, I'm giving this to you. I want you to have it. It's yours. I brought you out of it and I'm giving you the land to take possession of it. By the way, the land is 300,000 square miles. That's how big it is. It's from the Nile to the Euphrates River and in between. And I'm going to tell you something. The nation of Israel is not yet fully occupied the land that God has destined and decreed for her. There is coming a day. Why? Because the promises of God are yea and amen to them that believe. Therefore, that means God doesn't lie. He's not a man that he should lie. There's coming a day when God will fulfill his promise to the nation of Israel. They will fully encompass and inhabit the land that God has given them. So what does that mean to us? In the same way, God is not a man that he should lie. If he's promised something to us, we lay hold of that promise. How? By faith. And by faith we believe in the promises of God that releases us and positions us to receive that thing as it's made manifest in our life. Can you say amen? Amen. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain possession of it? So the Lord said to him, bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old. Three speaks of Trinity. Note there's a heifer, which is just a cow, female cow, a goat, which has those pointy horns, and a ram, which is part of the sheep family, and they have the rams have the round curly horns, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. Okay? So given the specifications, here's what I want you to bring. I want you to bring these things. And so it says he brought them, verse 10, and cut them in two and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. Then the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abram drove them away. All right, so here's what he did. Everybody say he cut covenant. Here's the deal. Remember what I said when I started this message? Confirming the covenant. God is holding up his end of the bargain, and he wants Abram to know that he meant what he said when he says, you're going to have a son. You will have a blood heir that is going to inherit your inheritance. I want you to know that. So here's what I want you to do. God gives him the dimensions. He gives him the directions. Bring this cow, female cow, over, and I want you to bring this goat over, and I want you to bring this ram over, all 3 years of age. I want you to then take them and cut them in pieces and lay them down. Part of it on this side, part of it on that side. And then what's going to happen is, and then a dove on this side and a pigeon on this side. Now, you haven't lived until you've been to China and been to the open air markets in China. It's pretty cool. I love that kind of stuff. I posted a picture of a friend of mine, but somebody got tweaked off about it, so I took it off my page. And it's Pastor Amos. He'd gone to mainland China where we've ministered to before. And in the meat markets, they cut up everything you can imagine. And they hang it up on hooks and things like that. And Pastor Amos says, I was in mainland China, and I went to the meat market, and there was a dog in the meat market hanging there. So he had a picture of a dog. You know, he snapped the picture, and so he posted it. So he says, Pastor Amos, did you eat any dog? It was a dog and a lamb. Sheep, whatever in there. And he goes, oh, no, I didn't have any. But you go into the meat market, and I'm telling you, they literally cut things in half. And it's so fresh. You'll have like a fish over here. You have lungs beating here, chink, chink, chink. And on this, and then right next to it is the other part of the fish, and the heart's beating here, chink, 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 chink. It's like, it's crazy. You'll have frogs leaping out for trying to escape, and every imaginable goodie that's there. You'll have every part of an animal hanging from a hook, and you just go, man, that's awesome. And they eat all of the parts. I like that stuff. That just intrigues me. I think it's awesome. Gory? All right, let me move on because I've been out of time, but let's just see where we go here. So he cuts them in part, and he says he arranges the halves opposite. So he cuts them right down the middle. Zzz, part of it here, part of it here. And you can't appreciate this. Now, I'm a hunter. Yes, you are. Yeah. So I know what he's talking about when you cut them in half. I've cut deer in half. I've cut elk in half. I've cut bear in half. I know what we're talking about when we cut something in half. I know what it looks like. I know how to, I'm from start to finish, that whole deal. So I can picture it all in my mind. Everybody say bloody. Bloody. And here's the reason why. Without the shedding of blood, there's no redemption of sin. Covenant is always sealed with blood. It always staked. Blood is always involved in covenant. Okay, that's why it's important. So here's what happens. He takes them and he lays them in half, and now he's doing what he can. The birds of prey are coming. What are birds of prey? Eagles, buzzards, ravens. Come on, help me. What else? Hawks. All I have to do is drive down I-5. They're sitting on the fence. They're waiting for a dead piece of road meat to come by. Zoom. They're so lazy now. These big fat hawks on I-5, they're just every mile or less, there's one sitting there. They're just waiting for something to get run over, and then, boom, they're in on it. That's the birds of prey. Now, here's the deal. What he does is he drives them away or off of the meat. He keeps them from the carcasses. Isn't it interesting that Satan is described as the prince and the power of the air? So he's beating the buzzards away from the meat, the covenantal agreement. So it says in verse 12, as the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep. It's the same sleep seen in Genesis 2:21 when Adam was put to sleep and God took a rib out of him and fashioned the woman out of him, which was Eve. We all know that story, right? It says, and a deep sleep and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to him, know for certain that 400 years, he speaks them prophetically, 400 years your descendants will be strangers in the country, not their own, and that they will be enslaved and mistreated. Everybody say Egypt. Egypt. I'm running out of time. Egypt. Okay, they're going to be mistreated. How many of you know that started out good, but it didn't end well for them? They were slaves. They started out, man, they were the champions. I mean, remember Joseph? He saved the day. He came into there by a mandate of God. He came in there, and he said 7 years of good times, 7 years of famine. So they put away for the good times. When the famine came, things went to kaput. And what ends up happening is he's the guy that's managing all of this. He's handling it. How many of you know we need some Josephs in our day? We need some Josephs rising up in this hour that is going to manage things in the United States of America because our government needs help. Amen. I'll just leave it at that. Maybe I'll leave it at that. Did you see this guy that was handling Obamacare in the state of Oregon took a leave of absence the day before yesterday? Yeah. Took a sick day. No, he took a sick leave. He's gone for a while. You know all about it. All right, I'm leaving that alone. Let me get back to this. I don't have time to go down that road. It's not our assignment here. Lord, we bless our government and we pray for our officials that they hear the mind of Christ and they would listen to Josephs that you would send them. All right, so it's dark and now he's asleep. He's out. He's conked. Anybody ever been under anesthesia?
Yes.
I hate it. Two times in my life. I remember when I was 6 years of age, I had my tonsils out. And so my brother, he and I had tonsils out the same. Maybe he was a little bit older than that because he must have been about five. I'm three years older than him, so five, six, seven, it'd be eight, I guess, something like that. So we're in the hospital. We're at Bennett Clarkson. And we're there, we're in the same room together, side by side. And so when they come to get him in the morning, they want to give you a little shot in the hind end to loosen you up. You know, it'll put you into E, so when they put the gas on you, it'll be a lot easier. And so being the smart guy that I am, I froze my hind end up so they could, it was like a steel bun back there. And they had a fight to get that. I didn't realize I was making it worse. So they got the needle in my hind end, shot the juice in me, and it didn't knock me out. It didn't even get me, woozy or anything like that. But I can distinctly remember when they came and were waiting to be taken in, like the older brother that I am, when they says, who wants to go first? I says, he does. Take him first. Take him first. So they took my brother Tom in. And then he went off in to get his tonsils out. Then they came to get me. They took me and wheeled me in. And I can remember this to the day. If you've ever had, the old, gas or ether? It was ether. And they put it on my face. And I go, I'm not sucking that thing in. And I'm fighting it for all I'm worth. I'm this like 8-year-old boy fighting this ether. And then they took it off me because I was holding my breath. And they put it on again. And all I can remember is my feet were going, and I was out, gone. The next thing I know, I woke up and I'm recovering. My tonsils were gone, and I was back awake. But I cannot tell you what happened when I was gone and out of this world when I was under ether. I don't know what I'd be. Anyway, let's move on. I would tell you another story, but we don't have time for it. It's not germane. All right, let's move on. So he's asleep. How many of you know God needs to get you asleep sometime? People wonder, why does God talk to me in my night dreams? Because it's the time that you're calm enough that he can speak to you. You're like Abram. You're out there fighting the birds. You're going to fight the birds. And God's saying, relax. I've got this covered. I've got it handled. So he needs to speak to you in the nighttime, in the night hour, because you're too busy beating buzzards. Come on. So he's asleep, just like the sleep that Adam was in. And the Lord said to him, know for certain that 400 years, I already read that, but I'll punish the nation that they serve as slaves, and after they'll come out with great possessions. Isn't it interesting that he's prophesying this before it happens? Because what happened when Moses went to Pharaoh, he says, when we go, he says, told the people, I want you to go all your neighbors and say, hey, we need some help when we depart. Get gold, silver, get everything, possessions. When they left, they plundered Egypt. Read it. It's in the book of Exodus. They plundered them, but they left with all the goods. Says they're going to take possessions out of here. Then he says, you, however, will go to your ancestors in peace and be buried at good old age. I like that. I'll take that. In the fourth generation, honey, this is where you were talking about generations. Helen was teaching on how long is a generation, because we're all concerned, when's Jesus going to come and all that. I mean, some say that a generation's 40 years or whatever. This passage says that there were four generations, which were 400 years. So if you go 1948 and 100-year time span from 1948 is what? Thank you, 2048, that's 100 years. So is it possible that in that time frame, when the fig tree ripens, which is the nation of Israel, that at some point in that duration the Lord could come? I'm not a date setter, please don't get me caught up in that. But it's just interesting to think about that as we talk out of the Word. Because some of you know you interpret the Word with the Word. That's called right hermeneutics. It's the science of the study of Scripture. How do we exegete a passage? How do we understand it? Because we interpret Scripture with Scripture. Everybody say amen to that.
Amen.
He says, in the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. Verse 17, when the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. This means the Lord showed up in person. Now, it's interesting to note this. Usually when you cut covenant, both parties go through. But God says, take a break, relax. I'm cutting this covenant. It's all on me, nothing on you. If you welch out, it doesn't matter. My end of the bargain is still going to be upheld. Because read it. Abram did not walk through, only the Lord did. Now, I've said this before, and I'll say it again. Look at our room, how it's set up. Most churches and most hall meeting places are set up so one people sit on one side and one on another. And when we do weddings, usually you have the bride's side and the groom's side. And when they walk through, what they're doing is they're cutting covenant. They're saying, you're witnesses and you're witnesses, and we're witnessing the event that is taking place today under God, the auspices of God Almighty, that heaven sees, the earth sees, and hell sees. That's why what you do and what you say is so important, because it's seen on three dimensions. It's seen in heaven, it's seen in hell, and it's seen on earth. Come on, somebody. Are you hearing me? That's why your words are so powerful. That's why your action is so powerful. That's why what you do is so significant. Because when you do what you do, or you say what you say, you either give the angels the empowerment by God, sent by the Father, because the Bible says in the book of James, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 14, are not all angels ministering spirits sent to the heirs of salvation? Say, that's me. That what happens is the Father releases them to come do our bidding. Come on, somebody. Or you release by your mouth the ability for hell to attack you, giving them ammunition by what comes out of your mouth. Oh, that's a whole nother story and a whole nother teaching. So he comes to when the sun had set and the darkness had fallen, a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch. You remember when the Lord showed up, it says that it is a pillar. He was a cloud by day, a pillar of fire by night. It says, on that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham and said, to your descendants, I give this land from the Wadi of Egypt, that's the Nile, to the great river, the Euphrates, the land of the Kenanites, Kenizzites, Kadamites, Hittites, Perizzites, Rephites, Amorites, Canaanites, Girgashites, and Jebusites, and Termites, and any other rites I left out. Lusite. The Lusite. Thank you very much. Lusite. You say, what are you saying there, John? I'm saying this. He confirmed the covenant. He says, it's all on me. I'm walking through. And you know what? You can stake your claim on the fact that I will do what I said I will do. Even if you don't keep your end of the bargain, I'm keeping mine. I'm keeping mine. I'm keeping mine. He confirmed the covenant. So, application to us. What's the word of the Lord to us? This is his promise. You've heard me say many times, 7,000 promises in the word. It might be good to find out what they are, because then you can begin to speak what they are over your life. And what you do is you release the Father and you position yourself for angelic assistance, that God's blessing is coming your way. Amen. That's why we want to know the promises. That's why we want to speak what God says about us. Last night we watched a DVD with Benny Johnson, Bill Johnson's wife, teaching on prayer. And she said something very significant. She says, you know what, when something happens, and you know we all face difficulties and trials, I ask the question, God, what are you doing? What are you up to? And then what I do is I align myself with what he's doing, not with what circumstances is dictating. And what is he doing? He's doing his word. So when we align with that word, we're saying, Lord, you've covenanted, and therefore I'm agreeing with you, and I'm standing upon your promise. Standing on your promise.